We who are true believers belong to God's eternal kingdom, which cannot be shaken. A kingdom that was throughout eternity, a kingdom that is now existing in heaven and in our hearts. That spiritual kingdom is in our hearts where he's Lord of Lords. And a kingdom that will always be. It's permanent and unchanging.
Welcome to Somebody Loves You Radio, the Bible teaching ministry of Raul Ries in Diamond Bar, California. With the recent homegoing of Pastor Raul's wife, Sharon Faith Ries, Pastor Raul wanted to honor Sharon's life of ministry by airing her Bible studies. So, on the first Friday of each month, we'll have a day honoring the life of a missionary, Bible teacher, grandmother, mom, and wife, Sharon Faith Ries. Stay with us to consider God's blessings for those who honor him with trusting obedience. Here's Sharon Ries.
The topic that's been given to me is consider the heavenly kingdom. And Sandy said, oh, Sharon, you have to do this. And I thought, for the past couple of years, I've been just reading about heaven and the eternal city. And I have about 23 books by my bed. And I want to know all about it. I don't want to go to heaven and just say, wow, this is a surprise. I was like, where's the river? Where are the trees? Let me see the foundations, you know, of the New Jerusalem. So it says, and we've been talking about this word, consider. Consider, think carefully, contemplate. I love the word contemplate, to just contemplate on heaven. Examine, ponder. So the two verses that were given to me was Hebrews 12, 28 and 29. And there's actually three studies in there, but I'm going to do one. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, and that's what I'll be talking about, let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. That's another study, and we'll just touch it for a second. For the Lord is a consuming fire. There's buried in our world a lot of lost cities and kingdoms of the ancient world, which have been violently shaken, tumbled, buried under the ground. The kings of those places have been weakened and they've been destroyed. And I love digging down to the earth. You know, I love the earth. I was telling my son Ryan one day, I was looking up at the stars and I was talking to him in Idaho. And I said, you know, do you think I'm in sin? I love the earth. I don't want to leave the earth yet. And he says, Mom, God created the earth for you to enjoy. I go, oh, that just takes a big burden off of me. So I love digging down and finding out these lost cities. And my dad used to take me to any place that a cowboy town, an old cowboy town. I love to find out what used to be. And thousands of civilizations are buried under the earth's crust, which have been violently shaken and demolished and buried during wars of foreign conquering kings. It's interesting now. I was living in Chile when there was a tsunami there. And other natural as well as God-ordained disasters have just destroyed every empire in the world. There isn't one that can withstand the shaking of God's hand. So let's look at Hebrews 12, 28 right now real quick, now that we have our little introduction about the destructions of the kingdoms of the world. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, the earth shook when the law was given at Mount Sinai. It represents the old covenant law. And this is what he was just trying to get him out of this and into Mount Zion, which represents the new covenant. They were so used to for years and years just following that old covenant. And now Jesus has come and set them free. And that word to be shaken is agitate, the rocks, topple by implying destruction. One commentator called it violent convulsions, and like the earth convulsing. There were those who were still clinging to the visible ritualism of Judaism and the things that can be shaken. They saw themselves places being shaken. Here, they're being exhorted to forsake Judaism, and they're directed to the pathway to the pilgrimage of Mount Zion. I'm on my way there. Are you with me? We're on our way to Mount Zion, to the new covenant of grace in Jesus Christ, to the city of the living God, to the heavenly Jerusalem. If you go into Hebrews 13, after the end of this chapter, it says, "For here on earth we have no lasting city, but we seek a city which is to come." My grandma used to sing a song about, "I'm homesick for heaven. I'm homesick wherever I go." And we would sing it with her. She was always talking about heaven. Just us being homesick for the Lord and for heaven. The New Testament believers were already on that pilgrimage. We read in Hebrews 11. We did our retreat last year on Hebrews 11. And they were going to the city that has foundations. They thought of themselves as strangers and pilgrims on this earth because they were on their way to the city that has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. We who are true believers belong to God's eternal kingdom, which cannot be shaken. A kingdom that was throughout eternity, a kingdom that is now existing in heaven and in our hearts. That spiritual kingdom is in our hearts where he's Lord of Lords. And a kingdom that will always be. It's permanent and unchanging. I remember watching a cartoon once, and this guy said, "Who wants to go to heaven and sit on a cloud and play a harp?" And I thought, well, I like sitting on a cloud and playing a harp, and I'm kind of tired right now. The earth and heaven will be shaken in the latter days. Matthew 24:20 says that. In the final shaking, all created things will be removed, and only the kingdom of God, the spiritual world governed by the King of Kings, with its city that has foundations and its citizens, that's us, will not be shaken. You are all our fellow citizens. I love to look at you and think of that. And when I go to other places, which I don't go anymore, I look at the believers there and I go, wow, these are fellow citizens. We're going to have all eternity to get to know each other. The word of God cannot be shaken. We learned that in John 1:1. In the beginning was the word. It was always there. The word was with God and the word was God. And God is forever, and so the word is forever. In Revelation, at the end of time, we see Christ as a man of war. I'm really into the names of God, so you'll hear a lot of them. As a man of war coming with his saints to defeat the beast, the Antichrist, and his armies, and cast him and the false prophet into the burning lake of fire. And it says that he was clothed with a robe dipped in blood. And his name is called the Word of God. I love that. I love picturing him, contemplating on him coming back on that horse, just as a warrior. Not that little baby, innocent baby in a manger, but here, God, the God of truth, our God, our King. All the laws and principles, this is an important statement, all the laws that we have today and the principles and the doctrines written in the Word of God will endure till the end of time, and they'll be permanent. Why is that statement important to me? Because as Christians, we can pick and choose what we want to. Well, you know, I know God says love everybody, but I really don't have to love this person. They've done me no harm, you know. We pick and choose. We tend to pick and choose. We do. If you want to be honest with yourself, we pick and choose which laws and which ordinances and which doctrines we want to hang on to. But they will all be permanent in heaven. There's no power on earth or hell that can destroy God's kingdom. In the midst of revolutions, the Lord's kingdom always survives, right? They may go underground, wherever they have to do, but God's kingdom in our hearts, his spiritual kingdom, always survives. Christ is the unshakable foundation which can withstand our emotional, physical, spiritual storms of life. I'm on my 15th year of breast cancer, fourth stage, and I've had those moments, I'll call them, not even that long, where I feel how you would feel if you didn't have God. Like, oh, you know, this is horrible. Why is God allowing this? But you can snap out of it in a second when you start thinking about God and you start worshiping God. Every time I have a procedure, I tell the doctor, wait, I have to talk to God first. And it's okay, tell me when. And I just get into the God mode, and then I can withstand everything that I've been through. So God's unshakable foundation will withstand every emotional, physical and spiritual storm in our life, as we saw even with Gail's teaching. The kingdom of God will not be shaken. It will endure throughout all eternity. And a few words on verse 28b. Because we have received, it says, it is ours for the taking, a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Let's have grace with each other. Let's have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. And that is just an incredible study there. We need to love each other. We need to forgive each other. We need to just, nobody's perfect around here. I tell the women I work with, why should we be mad at anybody who's having a bad day? I've actually taught them, come in if you're having a bad day and say, I'm having a bad day. So then we just excuse everything they're going to do and say that day. Just, okay, we forgive you. But to hold on to the most ridiculous things when we have a kingdom that can't, and we're all going to be citizens up there and we're going to be perfect. That's awesome. We're going to be shocked as we see each other. Wow, she's a good person after all. God's grace is unmerited favor toward us sinners. That's what his grace is. He gives us grace. So let's give grace to others. It doesn't give us the freedom to forget his holiness. His holiness is his consuming fire. Therefore, we should be inspired to serve God with grace, promise at the throne of grace in every time of need, acceptably, that he will accept us, well-pleasing, with gratitude, worship and adore him with reverence and godly fear, with reverence and godly fear.
This is Somebody Loves You Radio with Roland Ries. You're listening to a monthly special study featuring the late Sharon Ries. To get more information, visit SomebodyLovesYou.com or call 800-634-9165. Let's continue now with the final part of our teaching, Consider the Heavenly Kingdom.
And then verse 29, when I read that, I thought, oh no, should I just talk about that? Verse 29, for our God is a consuming fire. Whoa. So he's this loving, kind God that gave his life for us and died and humbled himself to the Father to forgive our sins. But he is a consuming fire. And I've done that study. You start in Genesis and you go all the way to Revelation. And he does not mess around when it comes to sin. The author concludes his lengthy warning to us, to we believers and to those Hebrew believers, that starts in Hebrews chapter 2 and it goes to 12, 29. Starts in chapter 2. To those who are tempted to abandon the faith with a vivid description of God's judgment. And I'll say a few words about it. God's consuming fire is found once in the New Testament. The word consuming fire. But it's taught in the Old Testament. And here's one of the scriptures, Deuteronomy 4, 23 through 24. Take heed to yourselves lest you forget the covenant of the Lord your God, which he made with you, and make for yourselves carved images in the form of anything which the Lord your God has forbidden. We need to get rid of any of those images in our mind, those carved images that we have in our mind, and we heard about that in these last few days. We need to get rid of all that. For our Lord is a consuming fire. He will burn it up if we don't get rid of it. And he is a jealous God. And I've also, with Joey Dawson, we learned about the jealousy of God, and that's his zeal to protect his loved one. He loves you so much, he will go to extremes to protect you from the sin that you're walking into. So he's a consuming fire. The consuming fire can be a blessing or it can be a curse. It purifies all that is unworthy and unacceptable in those who serve him. His holiness is a fire which must consume all evil, and it has to. He doesn't just let us get away with it. His love is fire which must burn up and destroy all that hinders and refuses his sacrificial love for us. It consumes all that is unfit to abide in his presence. Andrew Murray in The Holiest of All says, blessed is the man who knows his God as a consuming fire, but woe to him on whom the fire of God descends as on Sodom and Gomorrah in wrath and judgment. I want us to consider three topics talking about the kingdom of heaven right now. And like I said, it's just going to be a taste. This is just to whet your appetite to get in and study this. And the first topic is going to be the citizens of the kingdom of heaven. I want us to recognize that we have a kingdom, but we are citizens now, today, of the kingdom of heaven. And then the second point is the heavenly kingdom. And then the third is the King of Kings. And that should be the longest point, but it won't be. In spirit, believers who have accepted the sovereignty of God over their lives are already citizens of the city of the living God. The sovereignty. Sovereignty means that he rules over all. I like that saying that we used to use a lot, would Jesus do this, you know? It is a spiritual kingdom in which the Spirit of God wants to transform our lives and make us citizens of his kingdom. Sovereignty means dominion. Does Christ have dominion over your life? Dominion. It's not easy, because sometimes you think, I'd like to do this, and then the Lord says, no. And does he have rule? Does he have control? Does he have authority? There's no changing of the word of God. He says what he wants us to be, and we need to just obey it. We don't have to really understand it all at that moment, but we just need to obey. Does he have control? In Philippians 3, 20 through 21, we see that we are citizens of heaven. It says, for our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to his glorious body according to the working by which he is able to subdue all things to himself. A pact of scripture. He's going to transform us into his glorious body, and he subdues everything, all things to himself. We are those citizens of heaven now. Do we comport our lives? Do we live our lives as citizens of heaven? That's why I like to always think, we are citizens of heaven. Remember that, because we need to live our lives as citizens of heaven. Now we're going to look at the whet our appetite for the heavenly kingdom. Here on this earth, we're in that it's a spiritual kingdom. He rules in our hearts. He is sovereign. If he's not, make a decision right now. He will be sovereign from this point on in my life. It's the most wonderful thing on earth to be led by him. Believers in the heavenly Jerusalem will reign with Christ, and they'll have jurisdiction over the earth and during the millennium. The heavenly kingdom is a real place. I love that. When I'm a builder, and so I think of places where I've been able to help build missions and things like that. Jesus was with his disciples at the last Passover meal, and it was an intimate, solemn, passionate, troubling evening with Christ and his disciples at this last Passover meal. Jesus knew it was the last one. He was instructing them. He'd been instructing them. The devil had already entered into the heart of Judas, one of his own disciples, to betray him. Jesus knew that. Having washed all the disciples' feet, including Judas's feet, and identifying his betrayer, he gave them a new commandment, and that's John 13. And we did a whole pastor's wife retreat on this, to love one another. But he says, don't just love one another. Love one another as I have loved you. By this, all men will know that you're my disciples, if you have love one for another. But then he predicted Peter's denial. And then he comforts them in John 14, 1 through 3. And he says, don't let your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again to receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also. Notice that. Where he is, he wants us to be there with him. He is a jealous God. If he could pull the whole world with him, every person he created that he gave life to in their mother's womb. I look sometimes at street people, and I go, God gave life in a mother's womb for that guy, and he needs to be in heaven with Jesus. He wants everybody there. And he says, in my Father's house, as we looked at, it's a word that means a residence, an abode, implying a family, because he's saying my Father's house. And mansions speaks of a residence, a place, an abode, a dwelling place, a beautiful place of transparent gold. Streets are transparent gold. A place, it says. I looked up that word, and it means a spot. It means a spot that's limited, but a place within many mansions. There's going to be a place for each one of us within many mansions. The pilgrims and strangers' desire was that. The pilgrims of old believed by faith, had the witness in their hearts, and were convinced that God had prepared a heavenly city for them. In Hebrews 11, as we look back, it says, by faith Abraham dwelt into the land of promise, as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents, with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs of the promise, for he waited for a city that has foundations. Way back there, Abraham, without a Bible, without Revelation 21 telling him about the heavenly kingdom, he was waiting for a city that has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. The city which has foundations. It's the same Greek word, this foundations, as when you go to Revelation 21 and it says that the city that God's preparing has many foundations, 12 foundations. It's the same word. And here Abraham was saying many of these foundations. That's what he was looking for. Whose builder and maker. Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. And he knows each one of us. And he knows what we need and what we want. And what he, because all those desires he put in our hearts. And it says, these all pilgrims of old, they died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off. That's what we're doing today. We're looking afar off. They were assured of them, and they embraced them, and they confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on this earth. So we can't lay any solid foundation here. We are pilgrims and strangers. For those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. I love that, the word homeland. A heavenly home, their own country. Chuck, remember what Pastor Chuck used to say? If people say, oh, Chuck died. He said, oh, no, Chuck went home. He went home. So I tell Raul, if anybody, after I'm gone, if anybody says, oh, did Sharon die? No, she's home. She's home rejoicing with Jesus. And truly, if they had called to mind the country from which they had come out of, which Abraham came out of a big metropolis, they would have opportunity to return. But now they desire a better, that is, a heavenly country. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God. And then the last point, which is a smaller one, but it should be the largest one, is the King of Kings. And the Apostle Paul encouraged young Timothy to pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, gentleness, to fight the good fight of faith, to lay hold, to grab eternal life, and keep blameless until the Lord Jesus Christ appears, which he will manifest in his own time, he who is blessed and only potentate, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. So here's Timothy being encouraged by Paul, that he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's the kings of all the earth. They're all fighting for a kingship, but he's the king, who alone has immortality, dwelling in unapproachable light, whom no man can see, and to whom be honor and everlasting power. Amen. And potentate means that Christ rules as a monarch. He rules strong as a monarch over all the believers, over the whole world, over everything. He's monarch of the universe. And then in Revelation 17, 14, we go to the end of the book. We see the allied powers, the 10 kings who have received no kingdom. This is during the tribulation. But yet they receive authority for 1 hour as kings. I feel like calling them all up all over the world. You're only going to get to be king for an hour. Do you just really want to do this? Or why don't you just give your life to the Lord? You can be one of the kings and priests with us. So they get 1 hour. As king, with the beast and the antichrist to make war on the lamb. They will make war on the lamb, the scripture says, and the lamb will overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and those who are with him are called chosen and faithful. Lord, we just thank you as we look towards you for this special time of communion, of spending time with one another and remembering you. Lord, help us to remember all that you did for us as we partake with each other right now, in Jesus' name.
Well, we hope this teaching has solidified your trust in God's sovereignty and has inspired you to step out in faith wherever he leads. You're listening to Somebody Loves You Radio with Raul Ries. If you'd like to hear today's study with the late Sharon Ries, titled Consider the Heavenly Kingdom, just call us at 800-634-9165 and we'll send you a full unedited version for a donation of $5 or more. To further strengthen your confidence in the Lord's mighty presence in your life, we'd like to offer you Sharon's book titled My Husband, My Maker. It shares the moving account of how God walked with her through the dark early years of her marriage to a place of redemption and renewal. To order Sharon's book titled My Husband, My Maker, visit SomebodyLovesYou.com or call 800-634-9165. We'll send your copy for a donation of $10 plus shipping and handling. That's 800-634-9165. Or you can order by writing us at Somebody Loves You Radio, P.O. Box 4440, Diamond Bar, California, 91765. This ministry is listener-supported, and we're grateful for your tax-deductible donations. Thanks for your partnership. It's always great to be a part of your day, and we hope you'll join us next time for the beginning of a new series going through the book of 2 Kings. That's next time on Somebody Loves You Radio. This program is sponsored by Somebody Loves You Radio in Diamond Bar, California.